when she looks to the left, she has nystagmus beating to the left, a little more coarse and bigger beats. When she looks to the right, it is smaller and faster. So appreciate the difference. This is important because this means it is Bruhn's nystagmus. And the two main causes of Bruhn's nystagmus are, okay, Dr. Dan can't take. Okay, so see this nystagmus again. When she looks to the right, it is smaller beats. And when she looks to the left, they are a little slower, but more coarse, and you can see it with. So when you find asymmetry, you have to think of either a CP angle tumor lesion, CP angle lesion, or it can also happen in ICA territory infarcts. So ICA is very important for neurotologists, because in ICA, you can get brainstem causing a gaze evoked and also vestibule causing one side more. Not go into this. This is another patient. As I said, you can see when it's beating to the left, more coarse, beating to the right, finer and faster. So this guy also had a tumor in the left CP angle. This was an epidermoid. This was not acoustic neuroma. And this is the way we check the corneal. So the important thing is, the person should not see the cotton. Don't bring it in front of the eye. If you bring it from down, the patient cannot see it. So like somebody else suggested, you can do it from behind, but from behind you have to bend down and look at the, I don't know how it can. I find it easy to do it from front, from below. This is a lady who was sent to me by a psychiatrist and who was said to be unwilling to sit, stand or walk. And this is how she is sitting. And it looked quite psychogenic when she was just sitting. But when you looked at her eyes, then you can make out that she has gross opsoclonus. Sorry, again, this is ocular flutter. I call it opsoclonus. When the eyes beat rapidly in various planes, horizontal, vertical, oblique, then it's called opsoclonus. When it's only in the horizontal plane, it is called ocular flutter. The important thing is, these are back-to-back saccades. So it's a saccade and immediately there's another saccade. So it moves very fast, one saccade after the other. And the thing is important because it means either occult ovarian or lung cancer or an autoimmune disorder. Okay, this is a lady with 3-month progressive unsteadiness. The point here is to see how to look at the convergence retraction nystagmus. When you want to look at convergence retraction nystagmus, look at the bridge of the nose. That is important. So look here at the bridge of the nose. Keep your eyes on that spot. When you put your eyes there, you can appreciate, you can see both eyes, both of her eyes. And then you will see that her eyes are beating towards each other when she looks up. See again. Now look at the nose. Don't look at her eye. If you look at one eye, then you can't see the other. But when you look at the nose, you will see both eyes beating towards each other. It's very important to look at the nose. I will show it in internuclear ophthalmoplegia also. This is a lady who had come with breathlessness, dizziness and numbness in the head. And what she had was upbeating. Sorry. One minute. Sound is not going great. How do I mute the sound? Ah, yeah. Okay, so when you see closely, you can see downbeat nystagmus. which is become more often for bringing out downbeat nystagmus, you make the person look to the side and down. In this patient, it was getting highlighted when you ask the patient to look up, and also of course to see when she looks down and out, you can see that the downbeat nystagmus is much more prominent. And she had an Arnold Chiari malformation with also syrinx down here. Okay, this is a boy who was having 1 month of unsteadiness. These are all patients first initially, as I told you, when is it not, when is it central or when is it dangerous, when it is not vertigo. When the person is saying, I'm losing balance, that is unlikely to be a ear problem. So that is when you have to see. So this boy is going around with unsteadiness for the last 1 month, and you can see he's got a gross gaze evoked nystagmus. He looks to the right, the eyes beat to the right. He looks to the left, they beat to the left. So when you get this direction changing, that is a central cause. And it could be phenytoin toxicity, it could be some drug, but in this guy's case, it was a large brainstem pontine glioma. This is a boy with unsteadiness for 1 month. See his, you cannot appreciate the slapping of the gait, but when he was walking, his feet were slapping on the ground and he's losing balance when walking. He did not have finger nose ataxia. He did not have nystagmus, but he had a Romberg's positive. And you can see how he loses balance when you make him turn suddenly there. So this is ataxia, but sensory ataxia, not cerebellar ataxia. And the cause, of course, is B12. You all know how B12 looks. Again, two patients with I'll stop this one first. Wait. So see her. So these are two young persons. They have been having unsteadiness, which they call chakkar or dizziness, for the last 6 months. And they have been receiving various drugs. But when you see very carefully now, this is a short edited video, but you can make out that her hand has got a rest tremor. And when she holds out a hand, the right hand has got a tremor also. But it is there at rest also. You can see the hand at rest, right hand. And she had hypokinesia, so she was Parkinson, but the tremor was subtle. This boy is also Parkinson on the left side. You can see his hand shaking like this. It's moving like that a little bit, and there is reduced arm swing. So both of these, it was not thought Parkinson's because they are young, because the tremor is a little subtle. Now, when we point it out, or in an older person, you would not miss this tremor. But in a younger person, this little tremor, nobody is going to think of Parkinson at this age. And so it can get missed. If somebody, a gross thing is, of course, PSP, where they lose balance. That is the main symptom. And when you examine their eyes, you can get gross eyes like this, or it can be milder also. I will later on show some cases where there are, not today, but I'll show some cases later where this downbeat slowing is very subtle. So you have to see, compare with horizontal speed and down speed. One way of checking the speed of saccades. So in my clinic, I have a VNG where I can measure the velocity. But when you are seeing clinically, how do you measure the velocity of the saccades? What you have to do is ask the patient to look to the left, look to the right. Normally, you do not see the point in between. You see the eye starting here, going here. So you see directly the two points. You don't see the eye going like that. So this thing is a double thing. Normally when you also move your eyes, you go blind. Your vision is suppressed when you're moving the eyes. So you see when your eye stopped here and you see when the eye has reached the end. So vision is suppressed while you're moving the eye. Same way, when you are examining the patient's eyes, if you look at the eye and tell him, now look to the left, you'll see the eye in the center and you'll see when it has reached the left. But if you see it moving all along, that means the saccade is slow. So in this person, it is very slow. You can see the eyes as if, you know, throughout you are seeing them while they are moving up and down. So you can see aramse, but even lateral movement, you can see the eyes moving. Check again. So that is how you see the velocity of the saccades. If you can see, that means it is slow. Uh, Now, here the important lesson in this patient is internuclear ophthalmoplegia bilateral, and I'll show later another case sometime where we'll just see only cases where the internuclear ophthalmoplegia is very subtle. And what I plan to do is when we have the only case session, we will have a meeting, not a webinar. So we will have a meeting where you also can talk. And just now, I'm sorry, nobody can talk unless I enable that and nobody can be seen. So in such a big group, that is difficult, but we'll have a case discussion like session where we only see and you can talk. So here now the important thing is in this patient is to see the internuclear ophthalmoplegia. So again, focus your eyes on the center of her nose, on the bridge of her nose. And when you're seeing that, you'll see the eyes moving. Normally the eyes move equally like this. When you see one eye moving out like that and you see divergence of the eye, even temporarily, that means there is a lag of adduction. So adduction can be slowed. So gross internuclear ophthalmoplegia, you will see the no adduction. But mild internuclear ophthalmoplegia, if you want to pick up, then you have to look for this little while moving, the eyes diverge and then it catches up. So check that now. See in this patient how it, she looks the light. The nystagmus is not important. The abducting eye nystagmus is not the important point, though she has it here and that tells you, but sometimes you can have only slowing of adduction. So the slowing of adduction is the more important feature and not abducting eye nystagmus. If you look at the bridge of the nose, you'll see that the eyes are diverging when she looks to the left and they are diverging when she looks to the right also. She's got a mild left INO and a more gross right INO. This patient has come with Lockton syndrome. I told you he had initially three attacks of vertigo, which were missed, and then he got one second. Meenakshi. Yes, Meenakshi. Are I'm doing that webinar. I'll talk later. I thought it was something about this. So now he's come with a Lockton syndrome. He's got ocular bobbing. He's unable to look to the sides and only the movement left is up and down. So this was basilar thrombosis now, but initially he had given a warning. He was getting for 2 weeks attacks of only vertigo, which were missed by unfortunately, and then he landed up in this big stroke. So be careful when somebody comes with recurrent attacks of vertigo, even if there is no tinnitus or deafness, you should be careful. It could be a TIA. I'm not going over these. Wherever there was a video and the sound disturbed, I'm only going there. Okay, here now, this is direction changing nystagmus. See again, when the person, why is this not going? Okay, so now when the person looks to the left, straight, when he's looking straight, he's got nystagmus beating to the left. When he looks to the left, the nystagmus beats even more. So this superficially now is looking as if it is a vestibular neuritis. So at rest, the eyes are moving to the beating to the left. When he looks to the left, it becomes more gross. So you think probably vestibular neuritis on the right side. But when he looks to the right, the eye beats to the right. So it is direction changing. And this is like a Bruhn's nystagmus again. It's an asymmetric nystagmus. See, it's beating to the right. Little bit, but it is beating. So if it was vestibular neuritis, then even when he looked to the right, his eyes would keep beating towards the left. They don't change direction. In vestibular neuritis, the direction will always be in one direction. So right vestibular neuritis, it will be milder. When he looks to the left, it will be more gross, but it will still beat in one direction. When it changes direction, you got to worry. This is how to check for skew. So here now, the important point is, when you are looking, you want to see, I'll explain skew because many people have not understood what we are doing. So when I'm looking at you, if I cover one eye, the covered eye still looks at the same spot. So if I tell the person, look at my nose or look at this light, even if I cover it, this eye is looking at that light normally. In a person whose eye has gone up and one eye is down, Then when I ask him to look with the right eye, the left eye is going up there. So when I cover this eye, the left eye has to look, come down and look up. So you get this seesaw-like movement every time you change the eye. So one, you can try to appreciate the eye moving up, but sometimes you can appreciate it better by looking at the eyelid. You'll see the eyelid going up and down. So see here in this patient what is happening. The eye goes up. This eye goes down. This eye goes up. This eye goes down. This eye goes up. This eye goes down. So right eye is going up. That means right eye is lower, left eye is down. Left eye is higher. So the right eye is lower and the left is higher. This is called left hypertropia. So when the left eye is higher, you call it left hypertropia. If the right eye is higher, you call it right hypertropia. So see again, what is the skew is, again, this just takes 1 minute to do in a patient of suspected stroke. So there are three things you have to do in a suspected stroke. One, see the nystagmus carefully. Is it changing direction? See for skew. So nystagmus takes 30 seconds. Skew deviation takes 30 seconds. And you do a head impulse test, which we have seen earlier. I'm not showing the head impulse now, but I'll show it later. A number of head impulses to sort of give you practice on checking which side is affected. So I'm going to give you a number, at least 4-5 head impulses, and make you guess which is the abnormal side. But that is the third thing. So do a head impulse test, check for skew deviation and direction. All these things together should not take more than 3 minutes. And in 3 minutes, you will have an answer. Does the patient have a stroke or is it a vestibular problem? An MRI will not give you the answer in 12% patient. And so don't depend on MRI to give you the diagnosis. Okay. So if there are any questions, I'm willing to take up. You can raise your hand and I can allow you to speak. So we can do that today so that, you know, the person can also talk. So raise your hands, whoever wants to ask a question, and we can have a question. We are going to have epilepsy talks. We are going to have EEG also. An EEG course is going to be done. Acute labyrinthitis versus central causes, somebody is asked again. So that is the HINTS protocol. If acute labyrinthitis, the person has only one side nystagmus. So nystagmus beating to the left, whether he looks in straight, whether he looks to the right, or whether he looks to the left. I will show vestibular neuritis video later, I can show it now also. I can show you some more videos. If there are no questions, I'll just show you some videos. So vestibular neuritis, somebody is asking me how it is. No, I don't have it here. Wait. I don't have it here. I'll have to get. I'm going to make a talk with only question and answers, where we'll show cases, and I want you people to come out with answers, and we'll have a meeting where you can also speak rather than a webinar. So we will have that as a case discussion like thing, but I want active participation that time. So on the basis of HIT, somebody, Dr. Sharma is asking me how to determine affected site based on head impulse test. So I shall take a separate talk on head impulse test, because I will need to explain it properly, exactly what is happening. The vestibular system, basically the most important function is to keep your eyes on a particular target. So when I move my head to the left 30 degrees, immediately, before you can think about it, in microseconds, the impulse goes from the labyrinth to the brainstem and moves the eyes 30 degrees to the right. So your eye keeps looking at the same spot. When the left labyrinth is weak, for whatever reason, whether it's vestibular neuritis or not, when I move to the left, it does not give that impulse to move the eyes to the right. So it may give zero impulse or it may give 50%. If it gives 50%, then I move my head 30 degrees to the left, my eyes, instead of moving 30 degrees to the right and keep remaining on target. Do you understand? See, when I'm moving my head 30 degrees, my eyes are looking there now. So they have to move 30 degrees right to keep looking at you. If they don't move 30 degrees and they move only 15, then I'm looking here and still not looking at you. So I have to do a corrective saccade. And that is what you have to pick up. Does the person have to do a corrective saccade to keep looking at the target? The important thing is cooperation. If the person is drowsy, you can't do a head impulse test. If the person doesn't understand, because he has, you have to tell him, keep looking at my nose or look at this light or look at the camera when I'm jerking your head. So we'll see examples of that. If I jerk the head to the right and you find he has to correct the saccade, then the right side is weak. If I jerk to the left and he has a saccade, it's left sided. So Dr. Sharma is asking how to determine the side. I'm going to give you a test. I'm going to put up 4-5 head impulses and you have to guess the side. Dr. Katrak was going to talk on pupil. Somebody wants a session on the pupil. Yes, we'll have on pupil. We'll have on eyelid also. I have a couple of cases where only eyelid abnormalities are there. So whether it's ptosis, eyelid retraction, etc. So we'll have on neuro-ophthalm also. We are going to have diplopia in this week, I think tomorrow. Head shaking nystagmus, Dr. Anand is asking, and is there a vertical shaking variant also? And he's asked another question, dynamic visual acuity, how useful in bedside practice? So head shaking is, what you do is take the patient, move his head side to side like that, and then see if there is nystagmus. Suppose somebody has a right vestibular neuritis. When it is gross, you have nystagmus in the right side is weak. So the eyes start drifting to the right and he gets nystagmus to the left. So you will get a left beating nystagmus at rest in right vestibular neuritis. I will repeat. Suppose the right vestibule is affected. Each vestibule tends to push the eye to the other side. So the left one will push the eye slowly towards the right. So you'll get a slow component toward the right and jerk to the left, jerk to the left. So our convention is we go by the jerk side, but actually it is the slow phase which is abnormal. So he's got a right vestibular neuritis, his nystagmus beats to the left. Now, when the vestibular neuritis improves, gradually at rest, you don't see. Then in the next stage, you'll see when he looks, when you make him look to the right, you'll see a little nystagmus only. But if you want to bring out the abnormality, you do a head shake, you shake the head, you are stimulating both the labyrinths. So if right is weak, then you make the asymmetry more. So you'll see a transient nystagmus. I'll show you a video later of how head shake shows, brings out the nystagmus. So in Bruhn's nystagmus, coarse component represents cerebellar or vestibular component. So in Bruhn's nystagmus, you have to imagine something like, it's like mathematics. You have a symmetric nystagmus, whether you look to the right, you look to the left. But in Bruhn's, there is superadded a tendency to move towards one side because one vestibule is also affected. So if it's right vestibule, then you are getting a slow phase towards the right anyway. That gets added to the gaze evoked nystagmus and that's why it becomes asymmetric. Then dynamic visual acuity. So what is dynamic visual acuity? Again, as I said, the function of your vestibule is to keep your eyes stable. So if you have abnormal vestibule, when you walk, everything will start shaking like that. So what we do is a simple test for checking whether you've got abnormal vestibular function is to take the patient's head and move it side to side and then ask the person to read. If the visual acuity drops while you are shaking his head like that, then that is called an abnormal dynamic visual acuity. If it drops by at least one or two lines, then it is abnormal and it means vestibular. I will show a case later on of that also. So I think